Thank you. Krishna, Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Certainly not after quantity, at the price of quality. We just want pure devotees, and if that's there, then that will do everything in due course of time. Things will happen. Purity has its own power. Purity is the force. So that force will in itself act, and Prabhupada is very exacting. Just keep it pure. Don't be influenced by, talks about different people, sometimes talks about devotees, disciples who deviated, who've gone off to Babaji's and so on. And you be pure and keep this movement pure. Don't let anything come in. Before it, doctors come and go, and they're really coming and going. It's like Prabhupada's in the hospital or something, and Prabhupada's not in the hospital. But there's so many doctors coming all the time, prescribing all kinds of different things. And Prabhupada's very nice to them, because he's engaging them in some kind of service. But ultimately, he always says, just chant Hare Krishna and be Srimad Bhagavatam. Chanting Hare Krishna, actually, and right until the end, there's no change, there's nothing new that Srila Prabhupada introduces. There's one place, one time, when Gopkumar, and his guru's name is Jayanta, and when he goes to Vaikuntha, then Lord Narayan says, in order to inspire you, it says, I became your guru. In other words, it wasn't some ordinary, but the implication there was that the Lord directly became Gopkumar's guru. And he says, I became your guru. So one time when he meets with Gopkumar, and then he gives this instruction, I don't know the verse, but more or less the translation is, he said, chant this mantra, and keep chanting it with faith, and it will teach you everything you need to know. In other words, you just chant Hare Krishna, which Srila Prabhupada told us to chant Hare Krishna. And if you chant it without offense, that's what we say every morning. Avoid the 10 offenses to the holy name. If you chant it without offense, then ultimately everything will come. It will manifest everything. It will reveal everything spiritually, it will make the Krishna consciousness movement successful. Why don't other Gaudiya Vaishnavas who are chanting Hare Krishna have the same result? They don't necessarily have the same connection or understanding of what chanting Hare Krishna is about. It's not just about chanting it for you, but it's for chanting it for others. Because that's what Sankirtan is. It's about preaching and giving Krishna consciousness. And that makes it sum, that makes it complete, that makes the chanting complete. And that actually gives the potency by which Krishna consciousness both spreads and also purifies the chanters. Half a century, it's a long time. I wasn't there. 1967 was the World's Fair in Montreal. And I went to the World's Fair with my father. I was 18. And I went to the World's Fair with my father. And there were these devotees, they were in the World Fair Expo, it was called Expo 67. And they were chanting. They were sort of part of the program, they allowed them to chant, they were showing, I don't know what it was that they were showing, and I didn't know what they were. I asked my father what they were. I can't remember, but he said they were something, some kind of exotic people. And Srila Prabhupada, when he's reminiscing back to that 1967, it wasn't like some years later, quite a few years later, when I actually saw Srila Prabhupada, although, you know, within a year I was associated with the devotees. Montreal was the second temple Prabhupada opened. Prabhupada went from New York to Montreal, and he lived in Montreal. When I was going to university, Prabhupada lived in Montreal. He lived on Prince Arthur Street. He lived up one end of Prince Arthur Street, and I lived on the other, because that was about three blocks away from the university. I was going to the university every day. And Prabhupada was there, and I was there, and I didn't know. He was just a few blocks from each other. And Prabhupada stayed there until he got his green card in America. So he got to stay in Montreal for over 2 months. Staying there with the devotees. It was a very special phenomenon being on the planet when Prabhupada was here. You could feel Srila Prabhupada's presence. It was sort of a very, very special influence, a very special presence in devotees' lives. It inspired us to do all kinds of things. Some of them were a little crazy, but to be like living a full-time marathon. And it also convinced us that we were taking over the world in 2 months. Or if it wasn't, if the 2 months elapsed, then just the next 2 months. Srila Prabhupada's presence, you could, when you were tuned in, obviously the rest of the world wasn't tuned in. But devotees who, by his association, through his books, and by this sort of extraordinary, this extraordinary Prabhupada consciousness that spread, it was like a contagious disease from devotees. And because that's what, I remember very well, I was probably about 2 months later, standing on the street chanting Hare Krishna, doing Harinam, when it finally occurred to me that Krishna was God. I was shaved up, doing sankirtan and so many other things. I joined because of Prabhupada, because I never met anyone like that, I never heard of someone like that, and I never felt anyone, and I hadn't met him. I just heard about him. I just heard about him from the books. And I read his books, and I tried to listen to his tapes. That was the beginning of cassettes. That's when cassettes started. And although in the beginning I couldn't figure out what he was saying, just because Prabhupada's accent was so that you have to get used to it. At least I had to get used to it. And but here on this recording, Mahakrishna Maharaj is, or Bharat Raj is, writing Srila Prabhupada about the doll exhibit here in Los Angeles. And Bharat Raj was a devotee, an extremely talented artist. And he's the one who did all the doll exhibits, the dioramas. He was writing to Prabhupada, sending some pictures, and he was asking some questions. And at the end, he was saying, something to the effect of Prabhupada, please, because everyone was getting very, this is like July, coming on to August. Everyone was getting very worried. Prabhupada is very sick, and he's talking about leaving the world. So the devotees are writing him, and the devotees are visiting, asking him, don't leave. So he's also writing like that. He says, we can't be without you. And Prabhupada replies, whether I'm physically here or not, it doesn't matter. I will always be guiding you. So those are the literal words Prabhupada was saying. So in one sense, that type of potency and that Prabhupada presence, it's there, it's still here. It's definitely more difficult to tap into than when Srila Prabhupada was physically present. In other words, when Prabhupada walked in the room, then he was really present. But even when Prabhupada was on another continent somewhere, it was still perceivable. And but Srila Prabhupada, as Prabhupada said, I'll always guide you. And Srila Prabhupada is there as the, in Christianity they have this patron saint. We call it Pandavacharya. But Srila Prabhupada is like that. He's the patron saint of the Krishna consciousness movement. Whoever is a member of this movement, Srila Prabhupada is that person's patron saint. And as Prabhupada says in the introduction to Srimad Bhagavatam, says that one attains perfection by engaging in the service of the Mahabhagavata. And in one sense, that's one of the functions of the Krishna consciousness movement, is that our mission of spreading Krishna consciousness is the service of our parampara, which is aligned to Mahabharatas. And by serving them, Krishna then accepts us, because they accept us. And that's Yasya Prasada Bhagavad Prasada. That's really our process, somehow or another, to be favored by Krishna's associates, and then Krishna favors us. There's when this Gop Kumar goes back to Godhead and he becomes Sarupa, that becomes his name. Then one morning Srimati Radharani calls him. And he says, Sarupa, I have a follower, his name is Sharma, I forget what his name is, he's a Brahmin, Mathura Brahmin. He says, you go to him, you inspire him, and you bring him back. This Mathura Brahmin, this is how the whole book gets spoken. There's that Gop Kumar is telling his experience to this Brahmin. But this is how Brahmin, Mathura Brahmin, becomes Krishna conscious, is that Srimati Radharani, now Krishna's associate, she favors him and she says, you go, and she sends Gopamad, you go on the Gopamad, there's a spiritual world that comes down on it. And then he situates himself in a place where the Brahmin comes, and then they meet. And then ultimately, he blesses him. He tells him this whole story about Vihat Bhagavatamrita, and the Brahmin's sort of unmoved. Or at least it's not that he's unmoved, he appreciates what he's heard, but it doesn't really quite do the trick. So then, Gopkumar, whose name is now Suruta, he embraces him. And by his touch, then the Brahmin becomes overwhelmed with ecstasy and he starts to cry and he falls to the ground and he falls into ecstasy. And then he goes back to Godhead. And when he goes back to Godhead, then he also enters into Krishna's realm. Anyway, we're going to do last little chanting, one rest till 9 o'clock. That's sort of my limit. Actually, I really reached my limit when I hit Inish Rath. Well, coming back, I was working on tomorrow's energy. We think this Jayarama, Prabhupada said, it's a picture of the spiritual world. Again, it's just Krishna's names. And interestingly, Prabhupada's godbrother, Sridhar Maharaj, when he heard that we chant the Sri Radha-Madhava for class every day, we chant that. He says, that's such an infinite song. So what can we do? Prabhupada did it, so he told us to do it, so we do it. Yes.
Hare Krishna.